this January and how you begin the year is what determines how the year runs with you. You understand the principle of first fruits, that most people don't know the value and the importance of it. In Ezekiel 48 verse 14, thou shalt not sell it, nor exchange, nor alienate the first fruits of the land. For it is what? Holy unto the Lord. Ezekiel 44 verse 30 also lets us know the importance of first fruit. Ezekiel 44 30 said, and the first of all, the first fruits of all things, every oblation, every sort of oblation shall be the priest. Ye shall give unto the priest the fruit first of your thou, that he may cause the blessing to rest where? In Exodus 23, if you read verse 19, the first of the first fruit of the land shall be brought into the house of the Lord thy God. Thou shalt not set a kid in his mother's milk. In Exodus 34, verse 22, thou shalt observe the first, actually three times the Lord even commands us to do what we do. Three times. People don't even know that. It's actually three times before the Lord. He said, thou shalt observe the feast of weeks, the feast of wheat harvest, and the feast of ingathering. That is what they call thanksgiving. That is what they call the thanksgiving at the end of the year. The beginning of the year, the middle of the year, and the end of the year. Amen. Deuteronomy chapter 20, verse 16, Nehemiah chapter 10, I think verse 35, he says, and to bring the first fruit of our ground, the first fruit of all the fruit of the trees, yeah, by what? You see, I'm giving Old Testament, we are under grace. Okay, Romans chapter 11 verse 16, for if the what? If the first fruit be holy, the lump also what? For if the roots be holy, so are they. So what is the root? The beginning, the first fruit. So those of you who say you are believers, and one of the problems we have, people find it hard to practice the word of God, are political Christians. Christians who are political. Pastors, leaders who are political. And that's why you see them with all their title, nothing happens in their life. There's no reflection of God in their life. But the baby Christian, the lay believers, you see them enjoying God. But those who are baby Christians, who are grown-up Christians, those who are in leadership, those who are, you know, as it were, ordained with oil, never enjoy. There's always a vacuum and a void in their life that makes them begin to doubt the anointing. Meanwhile, they are not total practitioners. Have you discovered people that stay around pastors are always victims of problems? Yes, because they get so used to it. They get so familiar with it. Like, what is it? And at the end of the day, their life is dying, not knowing that God respects principles. God does not respect proximity. God respects principles. If you don't obey the principle, nothing. So don't just allow the year just go on. It's important that you obey. As a ministry, we do it. As an individual, I do it. Because that's what guarantees. Nobody's after what you have. God said, if I were broke, I would not tell you. He said, if I'm hungry, I won't tell you. You know why? He said, cut to Psalm chapter 50. He said, the cattle on a thousand hills belongs to God. All those animals, those hippopotamus, those elephants, as big as they are. God said, if I want to eat, I'll just go into the bush. I'll kill all of them, slaughter them. I will eat them. I won't come to you because what you can give me is a cow, at most a goat. But what I have there, that's my own, is thousands of animals. So if I'm hungry, I won't tell you. So if I say give, it's for your good. That's what God is saying. It's for your good. It's not because God is stranded. God is not broke. God is not broke. God is not rich. God is not wealthy. God owns all. He owns everything. So it's very important. Amen.